everyone. Flying Brian here at the historic Elmwood Cemetery here in the heart of Charlotte. I know that there's at least one actor, a handful of Confederate veterans and other movers and shakers here in the Charlotte area buried in the cemetery. We're going to do some exploring, so let's go. One of the very first stops is going to be the Fireman's Memorial just inside the gate and to the left. Let's go see. There it is, the Fireman's Memorial. It's a fireman on the very top. Over there is the bell. I think they ring that every time they lay the firemen to rest here in the cemetery. See if there's anything up inside. There's a clapper up in there. It says, erected October 10, 1883 by the volunteer firemen of Charlotte as a lasting tribute to their dead comrades. Fire department organized May 20th, 1875. Independent Hook and Ladder Company organized August 4, 1868. On this side it says, Pioneer Fire Company organized May 20th, 1874. And on the final side, Hornet Fire Company, and organized in 1867. All right, next up, after the Fireman's Memorial, we're in search of a grave from an animal trainer who was crushed to death. So let's see if we can find that. We know it's in here somewhere. All right, we found John King's grave. There's a emblem of an elephant and a palm tree on it there. You can see behind me. The inscription reads, erected by the members of the John Robinson Circus to the memory of John King, killed at Charlotte, North Carolina, September 27th, 1880 by the elephant chief. May his soul rest in peace. Well, I guess that pretty much tells the story, or does it? I found that the Robinson Circus traveled not by train, but by using its horses and elephants to move its wagons from town to town. Chief was one of several elephants that were part of the circus, and according to which account you read, he was somewhat ill-tempered and did not like his trainer. However, Mary, another one of the circus elephants, is said to have loved King and was known to protect him from Chief. Anyway, as the circus made its way through the city, a wagon apparently became mired in some mud. That was when King was asked to bring forward an elephant to help pull the wagon free. He chose Chief, which turned out to be the mistake of his life. The elephant pinned King against a cage or wagon, I'm not sure, and crushed him. Newspaper accounts reported the elephant then ran through the town toward the railroad tracks, trumpeting and scattering the crowd. Several circus members, with the help of Mary and another elephant, eventually managed to corral the rogue Chief and bring him back without further incident. Unfortunately, King died of his injuries the next morning and was buried that afternoon. The newspaper reported that his hearse was pulled by four white circus horses, and the procession was closely followed by the circus elephants. And that is how John King came to be buried here at Elmwood Cemetery. Here's one we stumbled upon that is a little bit out of the ordinary. It's a lady, Sarah Profiter was her name. She served in the U.S. Coast Guard during World War II. You don't see too many lady veterans in the cemeteries. I'm sure there's probably more than we realize, but this one at least lets us know she was in the United States military service. Now behind me is an interesting tombstone for sure. Stumbled upon this. I can't really read the inscription on it, but it says safe in the arms of Jesus, but it's like a wooden cross draped with a blanket or some sort of a shroud. I'm not sure. Interesting for sure. Maybe it's a grave of a child. It's hard to say. It has a bird on it. Several birds, actually. Safe in the arms of Jesus. Interesting. It looks like it's supposed to be sitting atop some rocks. Another interesting marker in memory of 1st Lieutenant William F. Neal, 78th Division, United States 8th Air Army Air Corps. He was born in Charlotte on the 4th of July, 1917, and he fell with his airplane over France, 24 January 1944. And it looks like they've never found his body. It's known only to God. This is the Confederate Memorial and Cemetery here in the middle of Elmwood Cemetery. You will find Confederate graves, soldiers, veterans scattered throughout, but this is solely dedicated to Confederate States of America veterans and soldiers. Here is the obelisk behind me. You can see. Let's go back on this side. Better view. Was erected by the women of Charlotte in 1887. And I do notice over on this face and the unknown who rest here. So I think maybe some of the unknown bodies were entombed underneath the steps of this monument. I do notice that there are two sets of rows that flank the obelisk here. And on the other side, the rows of these here, not the ones along the fence, but all these that are along these two rows, all died while in service during the Civil War. They're dying between 1861, 1865. So these soldiers fell during the conflict. All these soldiers died in some battle or of disease or of their wounds during the conflict. And all these stones along the fence line, they're veterans of the Civil War, that they died, they survived the war, and I guess as they passed away, they were buried along the outer area of the memorial. 1907, 1918, 23. He served in the military, but obviously made it through the war conflict. And as they passed away, they were buried amongst their comrades. Another interesting find, it's the grave of John H. Killian. It says he was killed on the railroad. And I found another one of the graves I was looking for. Charles Cochran Lee behind me. He was another Confederate veteran. He died in battle. Lee graduated from the United States Military Academy at West Point when the Civil War started. He mustered into service with the 1st North Carolina Infantry Regiment. He also participated in the battle at Big Bethel, Virginia on June 10, 1861. And in November 1861, he was promoted to colonel. He was mortally wounded on June 30, 1862 at the Battle of Glendale, when he was struck by an artillery shell while leading his men in a charge on Union positions. And another Confederate veteran, Rufus Barringer, I know from the notes that I had in 1861 when North Carolina seceded from the Union, Barringer raised a company of 100 horsemen that became part of the cavalry, North Carolina cavalry. His regiment performed picket and scouting duties under the command of Jeb Stuart, and he was severely wounded in the face during the Battle of Gettysburg. While recovering from his wounds, he was promoted to the rank of major. He continued to rise rapidly in rank, which is not uncommon during wartime, and soon was promoted to lieutenant colonel and then to brigadier general. Then disaster. He was captured shortly before the end of the war. And this is where a connection to President Lincoln comes in. Barringer was interviewed by President Lincoln himself at City Point, and then sent to a POW camp. It turns out that Lincoln was a personal friend of Barringer's brother, of all things. His brother requested special treatment of Rufus, which apparently Lincoln honored. As luck would have it, 2 weeks later, Lincoln was assassinated, and Barringer fell under suspicion due to his meeting 2 weeks earlier. He was questioned extensively to see if he played a role in the conspiracy. It wasn't until several months after the war was over that he was cleared and finally released. By war's end, he had fought in 76 engagements and suffered 3 separate wounds. Post-war, he practiced law here in Charlotte,
and also became involved in state and local politics. In a little known fact, he can be credited with helping to expand the state's railroad system. Before he died, he authored the history of the 9th North Carolina Cavalry, which I might have to go see if I can find. Barringer certainly can be considered one of Charlotte's 19th century noteworthy citizens.
Now I'm at the gravesite of Clement Dowd, another respected businessman and veteran of the Civil War.
In addition to being a Civil War veteran, Dowd was elected the very first mayor of Charlotte after the Civil War. Some noteworthy events that occurred during his mayoral watch was the establishment of the city's very first police department, and also a new city charter was adopted. Later, he served in the United States House of Representatives. He also did short stints as a bank president and newspaper editor. Also noteworthy was Dowd was a law partner with North Carolina's Governor Zebulon Vance.
Now, something you don't see too often, at least in American cemeteries, is the Celtic cross. There's an exceptionally nice example of this. This is the William A. Graham medical doctor.
And right next to the cross, or this grave, Jessica Van, wife of William Graham. Another example of a nice Celtic style cross. Common in Ireland, Scotland, but not in the United States. Another interesting find is the Holton stone. Gilmer H. Holton Jr. died on 7 June 1942. He was the first lieutenant in the Army Air Force. He was lost in the Battle of Midway during World War II. Good saying, freedom is void without sacrifice.
I'm now in search of Randolph Scott, well-known American actor, best known as a Western star, somewhere in this section of the cemetery. Success! George Randolph Scott's grave behind me.
Scott's film career spanned from 1928 until 1962. However, he didn't start out acting. As a young man, he joined the United States Army during World War I. After the war, he went to the Georgia Institute of Technology in the hopes of pursuing a football career. That hope, unfortunately, was dashed when he injured his back. That's when he took an interest in acting and went to Hollywood. Fortunate for him, his dad knew millionaire Howard Hughes, which helped pave the way to getting his first part in a film called Sharpshooters. He landed his very first leading role in 1931 in a film called Women, Men, Marry. Scott was even considered for the role of Ashley Wilkes in Gone with the Wind. During the 1930s, 40s, and even into the 1950s, he was a well-known actor and worked with the likes of Shirley Temple, Tyrone Powers, Henry Fonda, Robert Young, John Wayne, just to name a few. And without a doubt, he is mostly remembered for his roles in Western films. And in 1975, he was inducted into the Western Performers Hall of Fame.
Another interesting story, Charlie Hoke, age 65, killed by a lion, 1930. Said he was with the Melville Show. Tragic. Well, it really is a nice spring day here in Charlotte at the Elmwood Cemetery. I could probably spend days wandering around looking for interesting and historic markers. And we'll probably do that again in the future. But I will say this, I thank you very much for watching. Remember, life's a journey. Enjoy the ride. And as I just said, thank you very much for watching.